Excellent. Good morning, everybody, and good afternoon for those joining from Europe. Thank you for joining us today on our Monty Hart Conference. Today, we have really an expert in just about all things in interventional cardiology, but Holger Thiel, who's the director of cardiology at Leipzig. And Holger, you're someone I've always followed and read your papers that I have the utmost respect for and that I continue to learn for. So to have you join us today is a real honor for me. And I think it'll be an honor for all our colleagues to hear, you know, your thoughts on revascularization and cardiogenic shock.
Yeah, Azim, thank you very much for inviting me. Good morning to New York and to the United States. So we are already in the afternoon. And I will give you a glimpse into revascularization and cardiogenic shock. First glance, but also when I prepared this talk, I thought, okay, this is very easy. So you just tell them carpet lesion only and stage revascularization, that's it. But like always, there are more details. And that's the thing I would like to present to you. So these are my disclosures, which is mainly the funding I got for the conduct of all the randomized trials we have done or which we are currently doing. I will also show you what we are currently planning and what we are currently doing in patients with cardiogenic shock. So when we are talking about cardiogenic shock, and I mainly focus on acute myocardial infarction, that's for sure the reason why we are also thinking about revascularization, we can see that mortality is going down. You can see it here. This is a registry data also from the United States. From the formerly 80%, we are now down also in registries to somewhere between 40 to 50%, always depending on inclusion criteria for cardiogenic shock. And as you can see in all the large scale randomized trials, mortality is also somewhere in the range between 40 to 50%. Interestingly, mortality is roughly exactly the same in the shock trial published in 1999 in comparison to our Calpert shock trial. However, you have to keep in mind that in Calpert shock, we only included patients with multivessel coronary artery disease, and this increases mortality because we excluded patients with single vessel coronary artery disease, and these patients usually have lower mortality than patients with multivessel coronary artery disease. So nevertheless, we are somewhere in the range between 40 to 50%. And I brought you two cases from Calpert shock. Maybe they are helpful for the discussion we have later on. So the first one is a 60-year-old male patient. He had angina since 7 o'clock p.m. He waited for a long time and he arrived several hours later and the next morning at 1 o'clock at our heart center. And as you can see it here, so this patient was clearly in cardiogenic shock with reduced blood pressure. He was tachycardic. He also had elevated lactate. His glucose was elevated and he was also centralized with cold skin and extremities. We took him to the cath lab and this is what you can see. Acute blocked LAD, severe stenosed left circumflex and a chronic total occlusion of the RCA. This has been criticized that we included patients with CTO in our Calpert shock trial, but we can discuss this later on. So this is the first presentation we had in the cath lab. And then I brought you another case. So this is also a patient relatively young. He had out of hospital cardiac arrest, which has been resuscitated successfully. And you can see here the acute blocked RCA because of an inferior STEMI and a severe stenosed proximal LAD and also severely stenosed first diagonal branch, which is, as you can see, not a small vessel. So once again, patient with multivessel coronary artery disease. Now, coming back to the shock trial, published in 1999, where we had no drug-eluting stents, where we only had bare metal stents. Often there was still only plain old balloon angioplasty. And this trial was powered for 30-day mortality. And as you can see it here, for 30-day mortality, there was no significant difference with a p-value of 0.11. Because mortality was lower at 6 months, at 1 year, and also at 6 years, the guidelines nowadays say it's class 1B recommendation to perform immediate revascularization. I'm not sure how the New England Journal nowadays would make the interpretation of this trial, because this the original primary study endpoint was negative, although the 6 months follow-up showed a significant benefit with respect to revascularization. So nevertheless, so this is what we have in the guidelines, and numerous registries have confirmed that early revascularization can reduce mortality. So this is what we have to keep in mind. But nevertheless, all the things we do are currently based on this 302 patients randomized trial in patients with cardiogenic shock. So there's another very small trial which was stopped because of slow enrollments, a SMASH trial, and we tried to summarize this in our publication from 2015. Putting this together, early revascularization is able to reduce mortality, as you can see here. So I also brought you some considerations on the influence of time to revascularization. So we all know this from patients with STEMI without cardiogenic shock, that the earlier we are with respect to revascularization, the lower the mortality. And we have a similar relation, as you can see it here, from a large German registry, which has been published now 3 years ago, as you can see it here, for patients without shock, without out-of-hospital cardiac arrest, contact to balloon time. There was a slight increase in mortality, but not such a significant increase. In the moment when you have out-of-hospital cardiac arrest, the time from contact to balloon already increased mortality. And in the moment when the patient is in shock, either with out-of-hospital cardiac arrest or without out-of-hospital cardiac arrest, this has a strong influence on mortality. And that's the reason why even in patients with cardiogenic shock, we have to be as fast as possible to do revascularization. I also brought you some data on access site. You know all the guidelines. I only brought the European guidelines, but in the United States, American guidelines, it's the same. We have for all situations for STEMI, chronic coronary syndrome, non-ST ACS, we have a class 1A recommendation to use radial access. However, there's no specific recommendation for patients with cardiogenic shock. This is what we have to keep in mind, because there are also no specific data or randomized data on this. So we only have meta-analyses based on observational, on registry data. There's one which I brought, as you can see here, there's a significant mortality reduction if transradial access is used in comparison to transfemoral access. We recently published a sub-analysis from our Kuiper shock trial, as you can see it here. Radial access was used in Europe in roughly 20% of the patients, and transfemoral access was used in a little bit more than 80% of the patients. Like always, there are confounders. Nevertheless, we tried to adjust for this, and as you can see it here, after adjustment, 30-day outcomes, if radial access was used, we could reduce all-cause death or renal replacement therapy, which was the primary study endpoint of carpet shock, all-cause death, and also renal replacement therapy. At 1 year, nevertheless, there was no significant difference between radial versus femoral anymore. Nevertheless, once again, confirming, if you are a experienced radial operator, you should consider to use radial access also in patients with cardiogenic shock. Now we are coming to the revascularization strategy, which is probably the main task for my talk today. First of all, we have to look how often we have patients with multivessel coronary artery disease. So based on the large scale randomized trials and also the registries of the shock trial, you can see that more than 80% of the patients usually have multivessel coronary artery disease, which is much higher in comparison to STEMI patients without cardiogenic shock, where roughly 50% of the patients have multivessel coronary artery disease. So these patients are more sick and they have more severe coronary artery disease if they present with cardiogenic shock. And these are the four options we have. We can go for culprit lesion only. We can go for culprit lesion plus stage revascularization. We can also consider CABG, or we can go for, for immediate multivessel PCI. Looking back into the SHOCK trial, which is also important, and also the TRIOMPH trial, and also the our IIBP SHOCK 2 trial, this is maybe interesting to see. In the SHOCK trial, 38% underwent immediate CABG, and only 55% of the patients underwent immediate PCI. In TRIOMPH, this was already different. So the majority of patients underwent PCI, only few patients underwent CABG. And this was even less, as you can see it here, in our IIBP SHOCK 2 trial, which was performed in Germany. 96% of the patients underwent PCI, 1% only underwent immediate primary CABG, and 3.2% did not undergo any revascularization for various reasons in our IIBP SHOCK 2 trial. If we compare CABG versus PCI, which is a sub-analysis, which is not randomized based on the SHOCK trial, this is the only data we currently have. This is a non-randomized comparison, as you can see it here. The mortality between the two groups, CABG versus PCI, was very similar, although patients undergoing CABG had more severe coronary artery disease and also had slightly more comorbidities. So at least this might be reassuring for CABG in those patients with maybe severe coronary artery disease. Now looking for what the guidelines, at least until 2017, recommended. So European guidelines said it's a 2AC recommendation to perform immediate multivessel PCI in patients with cardiogenic shock. The American guidelines did not give any specific recommendation, but in the appropriate use criteria from Manish Patel, there was an A9, which means this is highly appropriate to perform immediate multivessel PCI in these patients with cardiogenic shock. Looking for the data, which were at this time out, we tried to summarize everything. As you can see here, there were only observational data, 10 observational studies published between 2003 and 2016. And you can see that immediate multivessel PCI was only performed in roughly 1/5 of the patient. And usually culprit lesion only PCI was performed in clinical practice despite having these guideline recommendations. And as you can see it here, based on registry data, culprit lesion only PCI had significantly lower mortality in comparison to immediate multivessel PCI. But we all know this are registry data prone to bias, and that's the reason why we need randomized data. And that's the reason why we also, as this was a rational to perform our culprit shock trial. And I brought you these two cases I've shown to you in the introduction. These are really two cases from culprit shock. So this patient with severe coronary artery disease, triple vessel disease, we perform PCI of the LAD, we perform PCI of the left circumflex, and also in the same session with 230 cc of contrast dye, we were also able to recanalize the chronic total occlusion. This looks fine, looks perfect. So this patient really has complete revascularization, as you can see it here. So the other patient, we perform PCI of the RCA, as you can see it here. It's not a huge vessel. We were successful in doing this. And oops, yeah, this is the result. And this is the result after PCI also of the LAD and the first diagonal branch, which looks nice at least in the moment. But the question is if this really had a benefit for the patients. Now looking for the results of culprit shock. So this was a European-based multicenter trial with all these countries participating in Europe with all the national coordinators you can see here. This was the 30-day results. Culprit lesion only had an absolute 10% reduction in comparison to immediate multivessel PCI with respect to the primary study endpoint, all-cause mortality or renal replacement therapy. And if you would have asked me before when we started the trial, I would always have said, okay, this would be in favor of carpet lesion, only PCI, but because mainly because of renal replacement therapy. And honestly, I was surprised that the main driver was all-cause mortality. So an absolute more than 8% reduction in all-cause mortality at 30 days, 43.3% versus 51.5% all-cause mortality. Number needed to treat of 12 for prevent one life for those patients with cardiogenic shock. So number needed to treat of 12 is surely something we have to consider when we are doing this. Renal replacement therapy, as you can see it here, there was a trend, p-value of 0.07 for less renal replacement therapy in carpet lesion only in comparison to immediate multivessel PCI. However, this was not statistically significant. We were looking for renal function because we have to consider what is the reason for the difference in mortality. I believe that in part it's the renal function. So overall, those patients with multivessel PCI had 60 cc of contrast dye 60 cc more of contrast dye in comparison to carpet lesion only PCI patients. And as you can see here at day 3 and day 4, those patients with immediate multivessel PCI had more severely impaired renal function in comparison to patients with carpet lesion only PCI. Maybe some other problems also may have occurred. So we were still looking for a possible explanation for the difference in mortality. And if you ask me, inflammation also plays a role. So those patients in the immediate multivessel PCI armed or strategy, they had higher interleukin 6, as you can see it here. And we use this also to build a new score for prediction of mortality in these patients. And as you can see it here, this new CLIP score had a area under the curve of 0.84 for the prediction of mortality in patients with cardiogenic shock. So this is a very useful tool, but we have to see if this is also as useful in clinical practice in the future. Looking for subgroups, I specifically brought these subgroups because this is probably important. So chronic total occlusion, as you can see it here, p-value for interaction had no influence at all on the outcome. And also with respect to carpet lesion only in comparison to multivessel PCI. There was no p-value for interaction which had significant differences. So overall consistent results in favor of carpet lesion only PCI in comparison to immediate multivessel PCI. Also, the type of infarction is important. Previous infarction, double or triple vessel disease, all these clearly showed a significant benefit with carpet lesion only PCI. And as a consequence of our randomized trial, the European guidelines now downgraded the previous recommendation from 2AC to now 3B to not perform immediate multivessel PCI on a routine basis. And we can discuss what does mean, what is not routine in this situation. Important, as you can see it here, the registrators were only the short-term follow-up data. Long-term follow-up, according to registered data, had no influence at all on mortality, as you can see it here. Like always prone to bias. And that's the reason why in carpet shock, we also had a long-term follow-up at 1 year. But you can see that the results were consistent and we were once again able to publish this in the New England Journal of Medicine, consistent benefit with carpet lesion only PCI in comparison to immediate multivessel PCI in those patients with cardiogenic shock. And important, mortality is mainly confined to the first 30 days. And the difference in mortality is also mainly confined to the first 30 days. Afterwards, as you can see it here in this landmark analysis, there's no difference at all between carpet lesion only in comparison to multivessel PCI. What we have to keep in mind, if the patient has survived the first 30 days, this is still a patient at high risk, which is also important. So this patient who have survived the first 30 days still has a high mortality of more than 10% to die within the next 1 year. So this is what we have to keep in mind. So, and this is probably the reason why we have to have a closer eye on these patients who have survived cardiogenic shock. Now the question is, are patients with shock, without cardiogenic shock, different animals? You all know the complete trial by Samir Mehta, published in 2019, which showed a significant reduction in cardiovascular death or new myocardial infarction, which was mainly driven by new myocardial infarction in patients with STEMI, without cardiogenic shock, in the complete trial. For this, I think to bring this into perspective, we have to look what has been compared in complete and what has been compared in culprit shock. So in complete, culprit lesion only PCI was compared to culprit lesion plus stage revascularization in hospital or within the first 45 days. What we did in culprit shock, we compared immediate multivessel PCI in comparison to culprit lesion plus stage revascularization. Based on our study protocol, we recommended to perform stage revascularization in case the patient had symptoms, in case the patient had ischemia, based on non-invasive testing or maybe also invasive testing with FFR, RFR, and so on, or in case there was a highly stenosed additional lesion. And as you can see it here, 50% of the patients have died at 1 year follow-up. Of those who survived, more than 30% of the patients underwent stage revascularization, which we did not count as an endpoint because we recommended this, and this is what we believe is clinical practice. If a patient had has a severe stenosis or a significant stenosis in other non-infarct-related lesions, this should be treated. And this is exactly this what we have done in culprit shock. So summarizing the way of revascularization. So this is, if you ask me, the way to go, culprit lesion plus stage revascularization, only plus stage revascularization in comparison to CABG. This is what we aim for a European multi-center trial, CABG versus PCI in patient with cardiogenic shock. This is still not decided. It will depend on getting funding. And this is at least what we currently plan to do after our so-called ECS shock trial, which will show you in a few moments. Maybe also important, I've shown you the new CLIP score from our culprit shock trial. We, as you all know, we have the SCI stages of cardiogenic shock, which has been published by David Barron in 2019. Now the score has been validated by many registries, as you can see it here. However, as you can see it, there's huge heterogeneity with respect to mortality prediction with all the different SCI stages. Look for this, SCI classical cardiogenic shock, mortality 10%, up to 40 to more than 50%. Also for patients with deteriorating cardiogenic shock, 25% up to 70%. So this means that this score is not perfect. We have to refine the score, and this is what we are currently working on SCI shock stage 2. And we hope to publish this within this year. Another important aspect, and that's the reason why I've shown to you the scoring. What we currently do, we do it more based on the gut feeling, selection for mechanical circulatory support. What we have learned from ILPP shock 2, 50 to 60% of the patients survive without any device. Unfortunately, it's still 40 to 50% do not survive. If you put in mechanical circulatory support in these patients who would survive anyway, you will not improve the survival. At least you may lose some patients because of complications, because of bleeding and other complications. I'm personally convinced that maybe 25% have a benefit from mechanical circulatory support, but then you also have patients where you can put in the best device on the world. You will not change the outcome of the patient because, for example, these patients have undergone resuscitation before. This is what we call cohort A, no device. Cohort B, yes, you should use a device. And this is where you can consider to use a device as a bridge to this decision on the ICU after revascularization. And this is also what we try to adjust in the inclusion criteria for our ECL shock trials. So ECMO, as you can see it here, this is what we are currently doing. This is a method and design manuscript. We are currently randomizing patients with severe cardiogenic shock to ECMO versus standard of care without routine mechanical circulatory support. We also implemented a strategy for left ventricular unloading. You all know that ECMO is increasing afterload. And if we combine this possibly with Impella, we are able to revert the deleterious effect of the afterload increase with ECMO to more to the left, and as you can see here. And there are data for this based on observational data, intra-aortic balloon pump, and maybe also Impella, as you can see it here, seems to lead to a reduction in mortality in patients with VA ECMO. And this is surely something what we have to avoid. I've seen this 4 times in my life, a fully thrombosed left ventricle, which is usually something which results in immediate death. So more data, we did this together with a group from Hamburg. Also match comparison Impella plus ECMO in comparison to ECMO alone. Despite having more complications, the ECMELA strategy led to a reduction in this, in mortality in this propensity matched analysis. Now, that's the reason why in our ECS shock trial, we have a clear venting strategy implemented in the protocol based on these criteria, as you can see it here. And we also have an escalation strategy in the control arm when we should consider to use active mechanical circulatory support based on hemodynamic criteria, based on lactate, and also on vasopressor use in the largest randomized trials in cardiogenic shock. Currently, there are several ongoing trials in cardiogenic shock, and I will show you those with mechanical circulatory.
Complete revascularization is better than incomplete revascularization, even in the setting of these patients.
That's a good question. So the problem with these patients in cardiogenic shock, so as you may can remember our Kaplan-Meier curve, so the majority of additional revascularizations were performed within the first 30 to 40 days.
Okay.
Nevertheless, the problem with those patients with cardiogenic shock is that these patients are totally different from patients with STEMI without cardiogenic shock. Many of these patients, or roughly 50% of these patients, had undergone resuscitation before. And even if they have survived, so many of them survived with some neurological dysfunction. So these patients went to rehabilitation. And it was difficult to assess if they really have symptoms or not. And that's the reason why this is always based on a individual decision by the interventional cardiologist when to perform additional PCI. Because these patients are so heterogeneous with respect to, then often they had pneumonia, they had some infections, they had sepsis. And that's the reason why the decision when to perform additional PCI was not so easy to be done because these patients are really so sick. They have so many comorbidities. And even if they were on the ICU, this took time until they were able to undergo additional revascularization.
Okay, great. There's a question from one of the participants, just really asking how things work in Leipzig practically. So the question is really, you know, could you comment in Leipzig how you use mechanical circulatory support? I assume in mostly in the shock setting, because that's what we're talking about. So what type of mechanical circulatory support you use in Leipzig and when? And also, you know, in the US, there's a lot of use of hemodynamic monitoring, right heart catheterization to make decisions about hemodynamic support. What type of support, weaning and so on. And is that used in Leipzig or is it used in a different way?
Yeah, so we are using mechanical circulatory support. If the patient is suitable for randomization for our ECA shock trial, all the patients go directly to the study protocol. And currently we have enrolled the majority of the
patients. In New York, you know, we do a lot of right heart catheterizations prior to even.
I had a question whether, you know, it's hard to say, but whether that had any.
There may be slight numerical differences with respect to the type of mechanism. Honestly, I don't think that there's a huge difference or this may have impacted the results. We looked for the echo, but we did not collect the data if this was more predominant right ventricular, left ventricular, or maybe B ventricular cardiogenic shock or failure. At least what we did, so we looked for inferior versus anterior STEMIs. This is what I've shown to you for the subgroups. So there was no difference at all with respect to anterior.
In the ECLS shock study, what motivated your decision to use ECMO as the MCS instead of impeller? Because everybody's now, you know, would love to see.
Yep, but just 1 second. I have to look for it. Is 1 second. Where is it? Yeah, here is it. Just 1 second. I have to upload it. So we just published this, and we are just putting all the data together for this. What? Okay, yeah, it's just here. Just 1 second. Oops. Just have to share the screen. Just here, just 1 second. Now you should be able to see it.
Yeah.
That's when I have to into presentation mode. So this is what we do. So we always put in an antegrade and a retrograde sheath. So this sheath, the smaller sheath is prevents from limb ischemia. But if you have such a situation where you have a 17 French cannula from the ECMO here in the artery and the 6 French sheath here, you always have a dead space here. Formerly, we just removed it and maybe I can show it. Yeah, so this is what we how we have done it until 2018, 2019. So we put in an angioseal for the antegrade cannula. Then we have put in this case, we 2 proglide to close this. And for the femur, so venous access, we used the femostop, but we often had ischemia afterwards. And this is what we do now. We put in a Swan-Ganz catheter. So we are using Swan-Ganz catheters, but this is now for a totally different situation. We put in the Swan-Ganz catheter into the common femoral artery to block it. Then we inflate a blood pressure cuff in the lower limb. And in this situation, in the cath lab, we have no flow here. And then I will show you, we flush this here to flush the thrombus in the dead space out of the situation. I will show you in a few slides. Mm-hmm. So this is how we do it. So just 1 second. So this is, so we already stopped the ECMO. Then we make the puncture of the large arterial cannula from the ECMO. Mm-hmm. This is, you can see it here. So then we put in a normal J wire. Then we, in the next step, we remove the large. Cannula, and then we put in the Swan-Ganz catheter. Then we inflate the distal blood pressure cuff. So in this moment, we have no flow in the femoral artery and also in the superior femoral artery. So this is what we create.
Oops. Yeah.
Just 1 second. Then we can see it here. Then we flush everything with saline. We do it several times. And by this, we are able to remove all the blood and also all clots. And then we close it with nowadays with this device, as you can see it here. And later on, we just the antegrade flow. And this is how it mechanical circulatory support. If it is impeller, if it is ECMO, has the risk of possible is in particular ischemic complications, bleeding complications, maybe also induced, maybe also based on the impeller you have from the impeller.
Right, right. Now that's great to see. And I think I feel very strongly the same way that, you know, the downside of MCS is all these complications. And so you have to know how to manage them and remove.
In pandemic SAVV ECMO, we have several different devices.
Okay, great. I have a few questions from the participants. Did you have another question?
Yeah, if I may ask one practical question of how to select and potentially ask we treated the culprit. We put in a balloon pump, but augmented pressure was only in the 60s. We eventually escalated to impeller, but needed ECMO as well. This patient ended up getting LVAD at the end. EF was like 10%-ish. And eventually, I don't think we could have done anything percutaneously that would have led to a meaningful outcome, needing LVAD eventually. But just a question to you, how you decide on what to select first and how you decide that you need to escalate to another device.
Yeah, good question. So as mentioned, so we currently try to randomize all the patients to ECS shock. So that's the reason why usually we start with ECMO. If we would not do this randomized trial, probably I would go for impeller. And in case the patient is not still in cardiogenic shock, always depending on the clinical situation, depending on comorbidities, depending on age, which is also important, then I would probably consider to escalate to ECMO. But usually in this situation, I would leave the impeller in to have, as I've shown to you, the impeller strategy in this situation, just to have active ventricular unloading in this situation. Nevertheless, so with respect to unloading, I also didn't show to you, or haven't shown to you, also very interesting aspects, but we are currently also more and more using is also left ventricular unloading with ECMO with a pigtail catheter. So this is kind of passive unloading. It's much cheaper. It costs you €10 or maybe a little bit more than $12. You put in a 7 French pigtail catheter into the left ventricle and you connect it to the venous cannula. And by this, it sucks the blood directly from the left ventricle. I got the idea from Marco Notch from Ljubljana in Slovenia, because they do not have impellers. They can't afford to use impeller in this situation. And that's the reason why he had this very simple idea. And this works. It really works. So we have several cases where we measured the pulmonary capillary wedge pressure with unloading with the with the pigtail catheter and without, and it really reduces the pulmonary capillary wedge pressure, also the left ventricular and diastolic pressure. So there are so many easy ways on doing left ventricular unloading. If you ask me, I do not believe in the intra-aortic balloon pump in this situation. So this is some passive unloading. But if you put in a 7 French pigtail catheter, this works. And you can also put in an impeller for sure. This is active, but then in this case, you have an additional large bore access, one additional possibility also of more bleeding, more maybe also hemolysis, which is also important. So there's so many different options. And this is what we have to learn in this on specific situations for specific patients on when to apply which device.
Yeah, that's a great point. We have a colleague here, Dr. Greenberg, who for years has been trying to convince industry to make a bigger pigtail catheter, because if you had an even bigger pigtail catheter, like an 8 French or 9 French, you probably would get even better.
But I'm not using it anymore. So far I know aortic balloon pump anymore. So we stopped using it and we do not use it in, I can't remember. So I came back to Leipzig to become head of cardiology here in Leipzig. Now it's roughly 4 years ago. Since this time, we have used it maybe 1 or 2 times. And in the last 2 years, I can't remember any case where we have used the intra-aortic balloon pump. We do well without doing it.
Absolutely. I must admit, I think here we see it most used by our heart failure colleagues for patients with, you know, chronic end-stage heart failure who are waiting, you know, transplant or VAD. They still use it in the CCU a lot. But other than that, the use has also diminished dramatically.
Good to know.
Holger, thank you so much. Incredible talk. The discussion was really phenomenal. We won't keep you any longer than the hour. I know you've got 5 more Zooms to do. So we really appreciate you taking the time. And thank you for a really amazing talk.
Yeah, it was a pleasure. So have a nice day.